God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please, again. I need you, Lord, I need you. Walking down these desert roads, water for my thirsty soul. I need you, yes, God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. Yeah. Oh.
Dead men walk enslaved to sin. I wanna know. To the riverside, take me under bad times. I need you, oh God, I need you.
Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips.
Oh yes it is.
It's like the sound of a symphony in my ears. It's like
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Yeah.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change.
Yeah.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that
have a little chat that I want to have with you as church family here today. And we have some changes coming up, and some of you are aware. We had a talk with our worship team a couple of weeks ago with regards to Trish Hadley and how she's going to be stepping down, has decided to step down from our worship department and leading it as the director. I'll get into a little bit as to why. I want to thank Trish for, where are you? Oh, there you are. Yeah. And Curtis and their children. I want to thank you, first of all. We have been extremely blessed, first of all, as a people, and just like as you led today, in the Spirit. Over these years, you picked up when Mitchell stepped down, and you were leading and working in worship all those years before that, and then you just stepped in and you led. And this team of worship people, musicians, and singers are extremely blessed because of all that you've done, and you've been faithful, and you've done well, and we love you, and we love the way that you have loved us, and we love you, Curtis, and we love your children, and yes, Edward. And we're very blessed with them in our lives. It kind of smacks you a little bit sideways because you go, well, wait a minute, you know, Mitchell, Shauna, Mitchell led the worship. He's not here, and there's a change that's happening again. And because we're a family, we need to talk about these things and just be really honest and sincere and just kind of talk a little bit about why, and with that, have a great deep respect for people and honor people and the different things that they understand and believe and choices that they make. I want to frame this with the statement, I believe it was J.I. Packer, a well-known author and theologian in his own right, talked about the body of Christ and how different and diverse the body is. And he made a statement, and he compared it to a tree. And he said, what we need to do as believers is that we need to focus on the trunk of the tree being Jesus. As if you think in the kingdom, in Christendom, we focus on the trunk of the tree, which is Jesus, and not strain with one another on the leaves and the twigs and the bark and the shape and all those things, but on Jesus Christ. Central. So within the body of Christ, we have many different beliefs and understandings and doctrines, and we love the body of Christ. It's the same God and Father who is over all, in all, and working through all. A little bit of the why. So Curtis and Trish have been in prayer, obviously, about this decision, and I have liberty to say this and talk to you about it because it's a big deal. It's a big deal. We have, as a church family, we've gone through a lot of change, and COVID had its challenges, and we've had people that have left, and you kind of jump to conclusions, you know, well, aren't they here, and why aren't they here, and what's really happening? Well, listen, hear it from me today so that you're not just like second guessing or going, oh man, things are just crazy or things are falling apart. Listen to me. God is on the throne, okay? God is on the throne. One of the things that specifically that Trish said when she addressed the worship team a couple weeks ago was that she said, we have decided we don't agree, okay? It's a good word. Agree is not disunity. We don't agree with the direction Hill City is going. And she said that. One of the things that they don't agree with is an aspect of ministry that we've been discussing here as an eldership, unbeknownst to you, for a few years, okay, during COVID. And that topic is women in ministry and the roles that they play. We as a church at Hill City, we haven't changed our doctrine with regards to biblical headship, of male headship within a home and in the church, that the elders of the church would be men who govern and guide the flock of God, and the doctrine are the main teachers of the doctrine, okay? Now, there's many variations of that within Christendom, as you know, And there's also disagreement around that, and people are allowed to. That does not change my opinion of any one person. And I fellowship with many churches and leaders and people. And so we can disagree, and we can make decisions based on that, okay? This doesn't affect actually anything in what Trish does. And as a worship director here, it doesn't affect her role, okay? But for their family, and God bless you, Curtis, you're a good man, and you got a great woman and a great family, this is what their decision is. We'll talk more about that in the days ahead for sure and help you understand, and we're available to answer questions. And please, you know, after, you know, love on these guys, okay? Because we love them. I mean, they're part of our family. These are kids to us. You know, we're not ending our connection to them, okay? But it is a change, and it's a big deal, and we love them. We want to just be straight and honest with you and answer questions. You know, we don't need stuff causing turmoil among us. We've gone through, everybody's gone through enough already, just with all the division, I would say, that has occurred through COVID and opinions around COVID. Like, you're more mature than that, okay? Now, worship team, church, obviously you go, well, that's a big change, and so who's going to lead worship? Who's going to lead the worship department? So obviously we've been in prayer about this. And again, it's not like some knee-jerk thing. Worship goes on. It's very vital in the house of God, okay? And we have amazing people that we're training, equipping, want to continue to do so. And worship continues. So what we have determined to do, the elders have decided to place Colin Wellard in as an interim director, okay? He won't be the guy that's leading worship like Trish is every week, but he will be pastoring, overseeing, training, and developing with a team of people that are already there, that are stepping up to the cause and working alongside. We had an amazing meeting with them. They just said, well, you know what? We're loyal. We're faithful. We love worship. We're here. And so that's what's going to be happening. So I want to pray. Let's just pray. Father, today, Lord, this is a lot for everybody to absorb, and probably why I made a joke about standing taller, that I can also do all things through Christ who gives me strength, because these aren't easy conversations, but they're important ones. Man, we love you so much, God, and we love the way you put us together. We say today, Lord, in agreement, we will not let disagreement cause disunity among us. We just won't. That's not, you said, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. You said that. That's what we'll do. And so, Lord, we honor Trish and Curtis. We honor their decision, Lord. We thank you for them. We ask you to strengthen them in these next steps of their journey. We thank you, Father God, for your purposes over their lives. We thank you, God, for the gifts of God in them. And, Lord, that they will only just grow and mature and flourish. Bless them. Bless their children. Bless their marriage. Bless their household. Bless their coming and going and their coming in and out, Lord God. And, Father, for you that would settle them in that which where they should be, God, in your purposes, we pray. So we thank you, Lord. And as a church family, Lord, we honor and bless them. And everybody said, amen and amen. Obviously, we could pray a lot longer, and I talk quite a while. But that being said, are you okay? And three people said, oh, yes. No, I don't imagine that you're just feeling okay about that, you know. And neither am I in that sense, but I also am committed to serving God and leading the house of God in my lifetime in the things that God has given me to do. And I commit that to you and your hearts as well. We're going to talk about the Holy Spirit today in the time that I have left. We'll see how much I do here. I want to encourage you to take some notes. We're going to spend the next 7 weeks talking about holy fire. We're going to be talking about the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We're going to talk about the power of the Holy Spirit at work within us. We're going to talk about what it is for you and I to live a life in the power of the Holy Spirit. He wants you to live a life in the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, it's interesting that a perfect 50 days after Easter, Pentecost happened. The Holy Spirit was poured out. Pentecost, Penta, 50. It was this 7 weeks of 7 days. And then on the 50th day, man, oh man, something happened. From the point of time where the Lamb of God was, that the Passover Lamb was offered by God. Jesus was offered by God as the sacrifice for the sin of many. God was preparing to continue to do more and restore his, basically bring about his perfect way for mankind and for the church. He was equipping you and I for more. Do you want more? Do you want more? Thank you for that, yes. Do you want more of him? Do you want more of him? If you want more of him in these next 50 days, and the challenge that I have for you today, it's the 50-day challenge of seeking the Holy Spirit for more of him. If you take my challenge here today, the challenge of the Holy Spirit, in 50 days, let alone in 10 days, this will not be the same place. You will not be the same person. You will not be. The Holy Spirit in my life radically changed who I was. For literally, it was the gospel, the word of God that saved me, but it was the Holy Spirit who freed me. And now the two of them work together in perfect unison to grow me in the power and the freedom of the Spirit and God's word. This 50-day period is also called the Feast of Weeks. Feast of Weeks. Well, let's feast on him. Him. Remember him. You know, like the Godhead, there's God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. They all have a very important and special role. Very, very important role. God the Father, who is omnipresent and omniscient, and at his word, everything is. And he always was, and he always will be. And then there's his Son, fully God, fully man, born of a virgin. Come, sent by God. God came and died so we wouldn't have to die, but through him we would have salvation by placing our faith in him. And then he was giving the Holy Spirit to come and dwell inside, that upon the born-again experience, that when a person confessed their faith in Jesus, that they would become born again by the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, babies. But Spirit gives birth to Spirit. And he comes and he lives within you. You, the New Testament temple, he comes and he indwells. But then, at the end of that 50 days, Jesus, he said to his disciples when he ascended, I'll read it in a minute. He said, you go and wait for the promise of the Father, because he said, and Joel, the prophet, said it, and Peter said it in Acts chapter 2. In the last days, God said he's going to pour out his Spirit, and then Pentecost happens. And he pours out his Spirit, and the Holy Spirit fills them to overflowing, and there was a demonstrative evidence of it, and they spoke in tongues. As the Spirit enabled them, as they were endued from on high, you serve a supernatural God. And God is every bit as engaged in the power of the Holy Spirit to want you to walk in the Holy Spirit, in the power of the Spirit. And we'll explain a little bit more as to why. You need to understand those two things, that there is a subsequent outpouring of the Holy Spirit, a personal Pentecost that's waiting for you if you've never had that experience in God. I'm calling the message today, saturate. Saturate. Because I'm exhorting you to be saturated in God with more of him, more of the Holy Spirit. living every day in fellowship with Him, being filled to overflowing continuously. It's radical. Wonderfully radical. The strength and the power and new power that you're going to have as you learn this and grasp this and walk with Him. Man, I had no victory over sin in my life. And I was fed up. I said, God, I believe in you. Why can't I beat pornography? Why can't I beat these sexual sins? Why can't I? Help me? Go and burn all, back then it was books and magazines and things. Burn it. I'll burn it. Burn it all. Well, what about the thinking? What about the seeing? What about the, I want more of you. There must be more. Oh, there was more, all right. Man, he came on me in my bedroom. Huh. He still comes on me. You can't convince me that that was not him. In fact, there was a voice in that moment in my bedroom after the presence of God lifted off of me, and the voice was, that wasn't God. And I went, darn tootin' that was. Satan, in the name of Jesus, get behind me and get out of here. You know, no, I don't believe your lies. But the entrance of the presence of God in the beginning of that outpouring and baptism of the Holy Spirit in my life began with me humbling myself and saying, God, I cannot do all things through Christ who gives me strength. There must be more. I need more of you to live in victory and overcome sin and be a bold witness for you. I'm a chicken. I was a chicken to share. And it began by me praying on the edge of my bed. And I began to weep as I said, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you for all that you've done through Jesus for me. Thank you for dying. Thank you for your word. Thank you for saving me and setting me free, not holding the charge of sin. Thank you. And I began to experience deep within my bosom gratitude that I had never experienced before. I was sincerely grateful and saying, more, I need more because I'm failing in less. And he came upon me. He literally knocked me on my bed, and some 30 minutes went by, and I was so just hot all over me. You know, as I talk about this, the Holy Spirit wants to minister to you, and no one's experience is the same. And I'll say this, you may not understand and you may not feel a thing, but if you will yield yourself today to the power of the Holy Spirit, the power that is in God, in the presence of the Holy Spirit, to come and invade and saturate and permeate, if you invite Him to in every area of your life, trust me, if you're sincere, everything's going to change. Everything's going to change. Do you know saturate means to impregnate? Life goes in and starts growing from the inside. It's a beautiful word. It means to imbue thoroughly or completely. To charge to the utmost. Are you that person that, so, hey, can I borrow your charger for my phone? I'm out of can I borrow your can I, I? Or are you that person that faithfully goes and plugs in your phone every night and makes sure that it's absolutely at 100% starting the next day? I'm one of those. I know other people that aren't. God wants you to be charged to the utmost every day, and it is an everyday walk in the Holy Spirit by an act of volition of your own will to press into God and to seek the Holy Spirit and to commune with Him and to be recharged and refilled every single day of your life. Saturate means to cause a substance to unite with the greatest possible amount of another? Do you desire to have the greatest possible amount of the person of God in the Holy Spirit living within you every single day? I mean, come on. It's right there. Oh, Lord, forgive us for not tapping in. Forgive us for not allowing this your incredible offer of more of you every day into our lives. Lord, help us. Game changer, ladies and gentlemen. Radical game changer. Was it John said, more of him, less of me? And saturate means to permeate, infuse, or overfill and pervade. 50-day challenge. Seek the Holy Spirit for him to fill you, refresh you, to saturate you and your life. Somebody say amen. You see, at Pentecost, there was a real radical manifestation of the Holy Spirit, and it was at that 50-day, and they went and they waited, they hungered and they sought, they believed Jesus' words to go and wait for the promise of the Father. Wow, I haven't even read any scripture yet. I will. Don't worry, we read the Bible here. And there were some things that were present there. There was the audible wind, there was a visible fire, and there was a filling of the whole house. And everyone who waited, all 120, were filled with the Holy Spirit. There were some 380 approximately that left, but there was 120 in the upper room, and they all were filled. But why am I saying this and bringing this to your attention as I go into the scripture today? Is that he, the living God, in you, the power of the Holy Spirit, so that you can audibly hear, you can see. It's the audible, it's the visible, and it's filling all of you. The permeation in the daily, in walking, in the practice of the Holy Spirit is so that you're hearing and seeing of the by the Spirit all the time. Not complicated, not foreign, but living. The Spirit today desires to fill and refill you, and his tangible, audible, visible, whole life presence or saturation is available for us. My first point, and obviously I'm not going to get into all of them today, is number one, and if you're taking notice, thirst is the first key to being saturated. Thirst is the first key to saturation. Blessed and happy are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. I look out in the audience here today, and I know a lot of the different things you do in your work. One of the glorious things about walking with God is this daily talking with him, communing with the Holy Spirit. It doesn't matter. You know, you may say, hey, I am no multitasker. But I'll tell you, in the Spirit, we're all multitaskers because he's saying stuff to you right now. He's saying different things to everybody in the room, and he's everywhere, and he's dwelling in you. And so he, the teacher and advocate, is working around the various things that I am saying. And as I read this scripture, God is going to do something in your life. You need to expect that because he's in you. You know him today. You're born again of the Spirit. Trust me, something's going on for you today. Look what it says, John 7, 37 to 39. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, let anyone, everybody say anyone. You're here, you're the anyone here today. Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. By this he meant the Spirit. Jesus was talking about the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Okay? Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given since Jesus had not yet been glorified. Not in that measure. Remember, also, Jesus' sacrifice to redeem us from sin, make us holy by placing our faith in him, right? Freeing us from the curse of sin, delivering us by faith, justified before God, making us holy. And now the Holy Spirit, he's setting us up for this Pentecost, for him to come and live in us, not just dwell in us, but to overflow continuously in our lives, making us, remember he's Holy Spirit, holy and empowered by him on a daily basis. So saturated that the Spirit now flows out from within you. Out of your innermost being will flow streams of living water. What a beautiful picture. What a beautiful picture. The glories of God, the power of the Holy Spirit, the very Spirit now flowing out from, because it's overflow. More him, less me. It's interesting. I didn't see this. Jesus' first miracle in Cana of Galilee in John chapter 2, it was a wedding. It was a come together of a bride and a groom in holy matrimony. And Jesus at this story in Cana of Galilee was Jesus' very first miracle. This is his very first one. And what he does at the wedding is he turns water into wine. It's very interesting. He calls for them to get these six jars. Those six jars were used for ceremonial washing. He says, go and fill them to the brim. You know when something's full, the ameniscus forms? If you just bump it, the water spills and overflows. He says, go and fill them. And what a picture this is of the new wine of God's Spirit. You don't put new wine in old wineskins. There's a new wine, and he's going to come and fill the vessel, the jar, which you are his living vessel. And he wants to fill you right to the brim with his new wine. It's this at the end, and I'll parallel this for you. The bridegroom is praised, okay, because for this great party. He says generally, They to show off, they give the best wine at the beginning, and then once everybody's drunk, they get all the cheap wine for everybody. He says, you have saved the best for last. Guys and gals, Jesus at Pentecost saved the best for last. It didn't end at Pentecost, because you read the book of Acts. The Holy Spirit was poured out. There was evidence of it. They began to speak in tongues. They were endued with power from on high. But thereafter and ever since, go read the book of Acts. The Holy Spirit was poured out and they spoke in tongues. The Holy Spirit was poured out and they spoke in tongues. The Holy Spirit was poured out. Holy Spirit was poured out. Holy Spirit was poured out. There was evidence the Holy Spirit poured out. And guess what? It still happens today, and it happened to me and it happened to you. And guess what? God wants to still pour out his Spirit in the same way. He wants to fill the vessels. Jesus is even pointed to this beautiful picture of the bridegroom and how Jesus saves the best for last. This consummation of his enduring union with us, filling us with the Holy Spirit to an overflow for an overabundance. His filling us with the Holy Spirit in his intimate union and daily fellowship with his bride. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you, the hope of glory. What an illustration. You see, in John chapter 2, verse 11, it says that this was the first of the signs through which Jesus revealed his glory and his disciples believed him. Now he wants to show his glory through you by the Holy Spirit so that others believe. And you receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you'll be my witnesses. He wants to show his glory through you. Thirst is a key to saturation. Thirst is a strong necessity and driving desire in order to be saturated. Blessed and happy are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness. So in these 50-day challenge, and those waiting on the promise in the upper room, it was around 10 days. I'll read a scripture. Jesus went around 40 days. Everybody saw him. And then before he ascended, and he said this, and then they waited. And boom! They were met. Would you take up this challenge? Thank you. You'll be glad. You'll be glad. Effervescently glad in the new wine of his Spirit. Trust me. It's going to change things for you. It's going to radically change things for you in your life. Point number two. Saturation is the key to daily holy living or overcoming. John the Baptist, he speaks of holy fire in Matthew 3, verse 11. He said, I baptize you, John says, I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me comes one, he's talking about Jesus here, who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I'm not even worthy to carry. He, Jesus, get this, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. That's not water baptism. That's Holy Spirit baptism. That's in the Bible. That's what he was talking about when he said, you go and wait for the promise of Father. And then they did, and it was fulfilled, and they were baptized in the Holy Spirit. They obeyed his promise, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. But it was being filled with the Holy Spirit and fire. It's an interesting statement, whose sandals I'm not even worthy to carry. He was talking about Jesus, God's Son, the atoning sacrifice, whole, perfectly holy. I'm not even worthy to carry his sandals. It's interesting, right? Moses, the burning bush. And the bush was burning. And God was speaking of that bush. And the bush was burning, but it was not getting consumed. And Father, God says to Moses, and as Moses is there, he says, take off your sandals, for you're on holy ground, okay? And this holiness that God wants to burn, that we would be ever burning but not burnt up like the bush, but now in a new way, by the beauty and wonder of the glory of the Holy Spirit permeating our whole life continuously. Wow. Wow. Don't you love God? Man, I'll tell you, I can't tell you that, can I? Anyway, I can. I'll say it in a nice way, but I was terrible. I had no self-control over an area of anger in my life, and I freaked out with the beasts that I had to work with. And I was not nice, that's all I'll say. I would have been arrested today if I was caught. I'll say it that way. I stopped. But I didn't know how to stop beating these poor animals. Terrible. And what a compromise inside of me. You're living today and you know. See, this the Holy Spirit is saying, that's a compromise inside of you. He's the counselor. He says, that's a compromise inside of you. It doesn't line up with what you believe or the faith that you have in your Heavenly Father. And you know, when you read your Bible, I know you can skip those verses, but those verses are speaking right to you about that struggle in your life. That's why I'm bringing them to you. So he was speaking to me, and I'm like, what a compromise. Like, I'm an idiot. I can say that. I'm a fool. So I cried out to God because I'm compromised. I'm not living for God. I'm like guilty, and I know it, but I don't have control. So I cried. I cried out to God. Now, okay, here I am. Why am I not overcoming? And I'm walking in the Spirit. Because I didn't cry out to God and ask him for help. And maybe I wasn't living as saturated as I needed to be. If you're dealing with depression today, get saturated. If you're dealing with anxiety today, get saturated in the Holy Spirit. If you you're reading in God's Word about your new identity in Christ, but the lies of the enemy over your identity are bugging you and lying to you, get saturated. Get saturated in the power of the Holy Spirit to overcome the lie, the devil, his schemes, put on the whole armor of God, all that, but in the Spirit. Sword of the Spirit, Word of God. Come on, but it's of the Spirit, isn't it? And that which you use it, and it's recalled to you by the Counselor, the Advocate who is fighting for you, with you, on your behalf. I cried out to God. God, I can't do this. Why do I keep doing this? Sounds like Paul in Romans 9. Why do I do the things I don't want to do, yet I keep doing them? Anybody relate to that? That's the human condition. I invite you, Holy Spirit, in here. Wave a red flag. Stop me. First of all, Lord, forgive me. It starts with repentance. Come in and invade this area and help me. Hold my hand. And literally, I'll show you what I did. This is on video, bless the Lord. Anyways, I'd go out there and I'm like, my gritting teeth, breaking fillings and stuff. I was angry. This isn't working. If something can go wrong on a farm, the animals are not very smart. I was less smart. But if anything can go wrong, it will go wrong. And it's not going well. And after all, I need to get down to church. I want to get down there and worship the Lord. My family's down there. Come on. You know, I'm a Christian. I got to be at church. And I remember walking out there and I'm angry because it's not working. And I'm raising the baton, gritting my teeth. And guess what? He stopped me. He literally stopped me. And I just went, yeah, you're right. Stop. This went, I've told the story before, but this went so well in the power of the Holy Spirit for me that I overcame that so much that one day we were loading an animal that did not want to go onto a trailer. And the guy that I was with was losing it. And it was like 35 degrees. It was in the summer and this thing's doing circles. We're sweating for half an hour. Couldn't get it on. He said to somebody later, my boss and my mom, he said, in my whole life, I have never, ever seen someone so patient with animals. And he was talking about me. I'm like, you get the credit because I didn't do this on my own. Oh my goodness. Notice that Jesus did not baptize one person in water. Do you know that? He didn't. But he's reserved to do something for you. To baptize you in the Holy Spirit in fire. Baptize means to dip repeatedly. Baptized in the Holy Spirit. Okay, baptized in water, that was once, full immersion. Now baptized in the Holy Spirit. A baptism of the Holy Spirit, but keep pushing the vessel under the water. It has the meaning right there in baptizo, to submerge like a vessel is sunk in water. Go get immersed in the Holy Spirit every day. Go get him in you every day. He's in you already. He's in you already. But be saturated continually. Be that sponge. Lord, I need more of you. And get saturated. Go in. So you say, well, that sounds weird. How do you do that? How do you do that? Cry out to him. Wait in his presence. That's what they did. They waited. We don't wait. Come on. It's 2020. Who's got time to wait? Let alone on an invisible force. We wait. We don't wait enough. Waiting more, hungering and thirsting is the key. So I describe this Holy Spirit working holiness in my life. He said it's a baptism of fire too. Fire purifies, correct? No surprise to you, the Greek word here is pyre, meaning fire. But figuratively is another word, pyros, which means fever. Fever is something inside, isn't it? Speaks of the holiness of God, which consumes all that is inconsistent. My life was inconsistent. I've had inconsistencies in my life. The key to overcome your inconsistencies, your compromises, your sin, and be purified by the fire of the Holy Spirit is by being saturated and having more of Him. You have to be passionately desirous to overcome. To overcome sin, and be baptized in the Holy Spirit. I'll tell you point number three. Saturation begins with an outpouring resulting in power. It says in Acts 1, verse 1 to 9, it says, in my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to preach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave them many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, While he was eating with them, he gave them this command, Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Remember John the Baptist? We just read it. I come, mine is the baptism of repentance. I baptize you with water, but there's one more powerful than I whose sandals I cannot carry. He's going to come and baptize you in the Holy Spirit and fire. Jesus says, John baptized with water. In a few days, there's this other baptism. It's not water. I'm going to baptize you in the Holy Spirit. Then they gathered around him and they asked, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? Restore the kingdom. Oh, yeah. He said to them, it's not for you to know the times and dates the Father has sent by his own authority. But he was building his kingdom. He was setting up a new kingdom authority. He was setting up a new kingdom order. It was all in the plan of God. He's going to pour out his Spirit into the lives of the people on an ongoing basis, to live under the power of God in that kingdom. He's the king of the kingdom with keys of the kingdom that he has given to you and I, and it's embedded right in there. And they didn't understand all that. It's the times and seasons you don't know, but guess what? You go and wait. What you got to know, and maybe you won't feel understand, but you go and wait. You go and wait. Because he says, you will receive, what's the word? Power. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. And right after that, after he said this, he was taken away before their very eyes into the cloud, and it hid him from their sight. As I said, the Holy Spirit was poured out at Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. The whole manifestation of that outpouring gloriously took place there, and there was this evidence of that. How did they know? Well, it says they spoke in a language of tongues, a language of angels. Gloriously all began to speak, and they thought they were drunk. Interesting parallel, isn't it? And it says, no, they weren't drunk. You know, this is only 9 in the morning. You know, no, God's poured out his Spirit. Okay? But it's been happening ever since. It was not discontinued at Pentecost. Read the rest of the book of Acts. After Acts chapter 2, and the days and the months and the years. The cessationists say it has. But it didn't stop. It didn't stop. This power, this baptism of power, is to be a powerful witness and to function in the gifts, the powerful gifts of the Holy Spirit, for witness, for salvation, unto the salvation of us, for God's purpose. But it's also the power to live a grace-filled life. You say, well, why are you making that emphasis? Well, it's a really important point to make. Because without the grace of God, the character of God manifesting, you give the glory a bad name. You do. Without grace or holy character, the work is defected. You know, you speak the tongues of men and angels, you can do all these things, but if you don't have the fruit of the Spirit love in you, you are like a noisy gong. It's very significant that it's also to live a grace-filled life. Let me end with this, number 4. I'm going to ask the band to come. Trish. Ephesians 5, 15 to 20, saturation is essential and daily. If you're an alcoholic, you drink every day, and you have a dependency on a substance called alcohol. If you start smoking pot and you get addicted, you'll smoke pot every day, probably more than once a day. Very addictive. So is alcohol. Now, those things are quite destructive, as we know. And, man, we live in the kingdom here to help people with life-controlling struggles, of which I was one and many others here. So don't take my comments here as a put-down. You're in the right place to get help. But saturation is daily. Say, why did I say an alcoholic drinks every day? Well, let me read the verse to you, Ephesians 5, 15 to 20. Be very careful then how you live. How are you living? Be careful how you live. Not as unwise, but as wise. How? Well, make the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. So as long as you can call today today, man, take the 50-day challenge. Like, wait, seek, hunger, thirst. Be careful how you live. You want to live in the Holy Spirit. You want to make the most of every opportunity. And what's being said here today? Therefore, don't be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. And he makes a parallel. Don't get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Don't get drunk every day on alcohol. Parallel. Because if you were dependent on it, you would. But if you were dependent on the Holy Spirit, wholly and completely, you would saturate, you would take him in and more of him for an overflow in your life every day. Isn't it beautiful? Isn't that beautiful? I get some of us charismatics kind of go crazy with it. Just get drunk on the Spirit. That's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying get drunk in the Spirit. Where does it say that, get drunk in the Spirit? It's not what it says there. It says be filled every single cotton picking day of your life, because the opportunity is there and you want to know the will of God in your life. You want to understand. You want the complete influence of the Holy Spirit in your life. You don't want other things. You don't want the lies of the devil influencing you. You don't want your flesh influencing you. You don't want people that have bad motives influencing you. You want to be able to sort all that out by living in the power of the Holy Spirit every single day of your life and having the Word in your life. Remember, the two of those work together so that you overcome sin and you're this bold witness, because the glory of God is manifested in you by the Holy Spirit, showing forth the character and the goodness of God in your life, because it's your life. It's your everyday expression in the Lord. Out of your innermost being then will flow these streams of living water. The only way to be effective in overcoming sin and living holy, the only way to be a witness, is to be filled daily, saturated in the new wine experience of being filled. How are you as I end today? I pray for a Holy Spirit hunger. I do. For me, for you, all of us. We're not like, oh yeah, this is for the spiritual ones here. No. We're all spiritual. My goodness. I'll tell you know, you step up to a banqueting table, lots of food. And some of us eat way more than we should when we get into that situation. But when it comes to more of him, don't hold back. Eat till you're over full. Consume till you're over full. Saturate until you're dripping out. It's not weird. I need it. You need it. How can I stand tall in shoes that have a scripture, socks that have a scripture, that I can do all things through Christ, give me strength? By the Spirit. You know what I'm saying. Boy, I have a lot more for you, but I think I said enough. And I want to ask you these questions as we go into a song here, and you just meditate. Actually, you can stand, because you need to stretch, and I'm going to end here. We love you, Holy Spirit. Are you be worshiping God, but worship the Holy Spirit. Thank God for the Holy Spirit. Are you thanking God for the Holy Spirit in your life every day? Lay your head down on the table. Table. Sure, do that too. On your pillow at night, and like you're talking to God, but you see He's right there as the Holy Spirit. He's in you. End your day that way. Are you living under the power of the Holy Spirit each day? You got to go home from this message as we start this series. You're going to get a lot more over these 7 weeks. We're going to help you. We're going to pray for people to be baptized in the Holy Spirit and overflow with the evidence of speaking in tongues. Changed my life. Are you living under the power of the Holy Spirit each day? Question one. Question two. If not, are you willing to give yourself up to the power of the Holy Spirit? If not, are you willing to give yourself up to the power of the Holy Spirit? I'm just asking you. Are you willing to? Are you willing to? Are you willing to? Are you willing to? Are you willing to yield to the power of the Holy Spirit? Okay. God really, 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 did I say really? Wants to affect change in your life. God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, can restore the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. So if you feel like the charger is kind of like, you're on like, it's got that little red, you know, your phone is showing just that little, you don't even have a bar left, you have half a bar. No criticism. There's a lot of things that suck that water out and leave us dry. But ask yourself those questions today as we close. Are you living under the power of the Holy Spirit each day? Because you can. But if you're not, are you willing to give yourself up to the power of the Holy Spirit and expect and experience that restoration in Jesus' name? Let's sing and then I'll pray.